goodness, I'm glad I can like print in like 18 fonts, so. You laugh. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Loving and gracious God, I thank you for this opportunity that you give me every Sunday to bring your musings, your words to your people. Lord, help me to step away from myself and away from myself, because they haven't come to hear me talk. They've come to encounter you and to hear the message that they have, that you have for them. Lord, I just thank you and I praise you. And I pray that your word is heard through me or in spite of me. May the meditations of my heart and my spirit and my mind be pleasing to you, for you are my rock, you are my redeemer, you are my salvation, and you are my friend, my great God. Amen. I would ask that you stand for the reading of the Gospel of John. We're going to John 20, verses 19 to 31. And I am reading from the Voice this morning. On that same evening, Resurrection Sunday, the followers gathered together behind locked doors in fear that some of the Jewish leaders in Jerusalem were still searching for them. Out of nowhere, Jesus appeared in the center of the room. May each one of you be at peace, Jesus said. As he was speaking, he revealed his wounds and his hands and side. Then the disciples began to celebrate as it sank in that they were really seeing the Lord. I give you the gift of peace. In the same way the Father sent me, I am now sending you. Now he drew close enough to each of them that they could feel his breath. He breathed on them. Welcome the Holy Spirit of the living God. You now have the mantle of God's forgiveness. As you go, you are able to share the life-giving power to forgive sins or to withhold forgiveness. All of the 11 were present with the exception of Thomas. He heard the accounts of each brother's interaction with the Lord. We have seen the Lord, they said. Thomas said, well, until I see his hands, feel the wounds and the nails, and put my hand into his side, I won't believe what you are saying. 8 days later, they were gathered again behind locked doors, and Jesus reappeared. This time, Thomas was with them. May each one of you be at peace. He drew close to Thomas. Reach out and touch me. See the punctures in my hands, reach out your hand and put it in my side. Leave behind your faithfulness, unfaithfulness, and believe. Thomas, filled with emotion, said, you are the one true God and the Lord of my life. Thomas, you have faith because you've seen me. Blessed are all those who never see me and yet they still believe. Jesus performed many other wondrous signs that are not written in this book. These accounts are recorded so that you might believe that Jesus is the anointed, the liberating King, the Son of God, because believing grants you the life he came to share. The word of God for you and me, the children of God. Thanks be to God. Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Yay. Mary ran back to the disciples and told them everything that had happened that resurrection morning by the empty tomb. She told them that she had seen the Lord. They must have thought she was hallucinating. She was grieved by the death of the person who saw the good in her, the one who had to live in her. They had no idea what was going to happen later that evening, something that would change their and our world forever. As they gathered there in the locker room because of the fear of what might happen to them, there was a hush as they thought about the events of 3 days ago, when all of a sudden Jesus appeared out of nowhere. They were shocked and relieved to see their teacher again. Unfortunately, Thomas was missing. He would have been so happy to hear the news, right? Right? He'd be real happy then. Yeah. As they told Thomas all that had happened, he wouldn't. Well, he couldn't believe the story as he was being told. He wanted proof. As they all, including Thomas, gathered together a few days later, Jesus again appeared to them. Knowing how skeptical Thomas was about the resurrection, Jesus offered him the chance to get his proof. In seeing Jesus, Thomas fell to the floor, realizing that it was really all true. Jesus had come back as he said he would. Oh, Thomas, how could you have done it? Doubt. Distrust, distrustfulness, misdoubt, misgiving, mistrust, mistrustfulness again, query, reservation, skepticism, suspicion, uncertainty, yeah, doubt. To be uncertain about, and I doubt he's right. To lack confidence in, okay, I doubted my own judgment. How about to consider unlikely? I doubt I can go tonight. How many here this morning ever doubted something or someone? At some point in life, you doubted somebody, right? Why did you doubt? Why? We use phrases like, you know, I'll believe it when I see it, right? We need to see proof before we believe. There are things like gravity and air that we can't see, but we believe. Why do you think we have to see the proof? Why? Why is participation? Chris, yeah. Why do we have to see the proof?
So that we can understand what we need to understand.
So that we can understand what we need to understand. Okay. Seeing is believing. Is seeing really believing? Well, I mean, we live in a society. We live in a world that seeing is believing. If you can't see it, it doesn't exist. And if you try to make it exist, they explain it away. Right? You know, sometimes miracles happen and people explain it away because, you know, they don't understand it. They don't believe it, right? We as humanity, we're visual. Okay, the see it, to believe it thing. We are visual. We need to see things. You know, I know I'm a visual learner, okay? I learn better when someone is showing me how to do something rather than reading it out of a book. That's just who I am. That's what I do. I think a lot of people are like that. Show me how, don't tell me how to do it. Show me how to do it and I'll know how to do it, right? In the scripture from this morning, we hear about some visual learning. First, we have the disciples who gather together in the watch room. Now, it doesn't tell us that they needed to see, but when Mary came and told her they'd seen the Lord, they probably thought she was crazy, okay? They knew what had happened 3 days prior. They were probably grieving their loss. You know, probably thinking, oh, what a cruel joke, Mary. What a cruel joke. Let us greet in peace. You are not being funny. They must have thought to themselves. Then Jesus appeared. Shocked and amazed, they celebrated the joyous reunion with their rabbi. Seeing Jesus resurrected, they were able to believe what he had told them before. Seeing was believing to them. How many times have we liked those disciples? We need to see something in order to believe it. we may talk to people and they say they're going to change, and so we said, well, we'll see it. You know, when we see it, we'll believe it. And sometimes if we believe in them before we see it a lot sooner, or we actually just see it. Because when we say, you know, we'll see it, when we see it, we'll believe it, we're still doubting them, I think, instead of believing, giving them, you know, the chance to prove it. If we say, I'll believe it when I see it. But Thomas was missing that day. So, a few days later, as they were gathered, as I said, Thomas was with them again. Now again, they received their visual reminder, and Thomas couldn't deny what his eyes beheld. Jesus in the flesh. Jesus gave him a chance to touch him, to feel him. But just the sight of Jesus was enough for Thomas. Seeing was believing for him. The disciples had a chance to see the resurrected Jesus. But all who would follow, that would be you and I, but we don't have that same privilege. With us, it comes down to a matter of faith. Do we believe God's word about Jesus? Do we believe it? Do we believe Jesus' word in his scripture? When he said, blessed are all those who never see me, yet they believe. We are blessed because we believe, just as we believe and have faith in air and gravity without seeing it. For you and I, as Christ followers, seeing is not believing. Remember, we can't see Jesus standing right in front of us sometimes. We as believers, by faith, declare that believing is seeing. Think of the road to Emmaus. How Jesus walked with them, but because of all that had been going on, their focus was on the temple, on the world, and they were believing that Jesus was dead. If they believed what Jesus had said, they would have noticed Jesus, I think, right away, because they never would have gone with what was going on in the world around them. They'd be focusing on Jesus instead of the world. The world does not see because the world doesn't believe. We are able to see God working because we believe God's working. As you said in this world, Chuck, about the robin. We believe because we see. Now here's a thought. Here we go. The world cannot see Jesus or God because they don't believe, right? You all agree with me? Shake your heads. Yes, no, you agree with me. The world cannot see because they don't believe, right? Okay. Now we all agree on this, right? Okay, here's the mind-blowing part, okay? What if we let God and Jesus be seen in you and me so the doubting world would see and believe like Thomas did? Think about it. What if, now I'm really reaching here, okay guys? I'm really reaching here. What if that is part of our calling as Christ follows? What if that's one of the part of our calling? To be the image, to be the tangible thing that is in the world, for the world, who is looking for something or someone to hold on to. It's searching. There are many doubting Thomases out there. Are you willing, this is a challenge, are you and I willing to appear among them and be the image of Jesus Christ, the resurrected King of Kings and Lord of Lords? Are you and I willing to be the vessel of Jesus Christ as he says to the faithless world, leave behind your faithlessness and believe? Believing truly is seeing. Let us help others to see as we live as the resurrection